What would the Ewing Ranch be without the watchful eye of Ray Krebbs from the hit series Dallas? Here's a great guy. Here's Steve Kanaly. Hi, my friend.
Nice to see you.
See you.
Thank you.
Last time I saw you was in Las Vegas, and I had you going through. You were doing something you'd never done before, and I've never seen you that. And yet you were wonderful doing it.
Well, thank you. Did it work? What did you do? It was a pilot sort of situation. And you had me doing.
I was hosting a variety show.
And we had the Orsini orangutans on there, and I had the crazy voices. The guy was with me on the show. Rip Taylor.
He's wonderful.
Oh, it was so much fun. I was a little nervous, but he trusted me to go out and do this variety show. I mean, you do beauty
shows. No, that's what I was just gonna say. It's like this universe.
I'm the kind of guy. I said, well, sure, you want me to do it. I've never done it before, but I'll give it a try.
That's the reason to do it.
And it was real fun. I really enjoyed it.
You were good, and I've got it. You may have a variety show.
Well,
that's just what you need right now.
Well, I don't know. It might be fun. I certainly enjoyed it that time.
I am hearing all kinds of rumors, and it's funny how you hear these things through grapevine about what's going on Dallas this season.
Well, I'm pleased that people still care.
Oh, do they care?
They do, and we're in 85 countries now, Mike. And
you can't hide anywhere, can you?
No, I can't. But it's a new season, and it's a real fun one. I think it's the best written one we've ever had. We're finally going to deal with an issue of who really is going to inherit all this wealth after Jock's death, and where does the money go, and the will is a big part of the season. And it sets up a conflict between JR and Bobby that goes throughout the season.
And you and Susan Howard had some trouble this past season. Can we expect to see you mend your differences by the next season?
Had everybody upset. I'll tell you that.
Did you get response that they didn't like the fact that you were?
They hated it.
Did they?
Oh,
good.
No.
Oh, I love it. I hope they feel the same way.
You're doing the same thing.
Yeah.
But you're writing a book about the Ewings on the show.
No, why not? No. Meanwhile, Gary's having the greatest fling of his life with the most gorgeous female in the world.
And he's part of his thing in the show is he inherits a lot of money.
Yeah, but the interest.
Yeah, but it's great. We all inherit $10 million, all the men.
Just what a nice, neat sum.
But Gary, because Gary has had personal problems, is limited to the interest only.
Interest on that.
But what is that?
He still has a couple million a year. Right.
Oh,
he still has a good time. They buy a house in Malibu, Gary and Abby do.
Right.
They get a yacht eventually.
Right.
Meanwhile, Val, just sits there at home writing her book, I just hate it.
I love the sequence with you and Mike on the show. That was real fun. Did you have fun doing it?
Oh, I had a ball doing it. It was so strange because you walk in and you don't see any from in your faces. And I'm looking for Joan. Mm-hmm. And they say, well, go ahead and do these introductions. And I'm walking out, and no applause. And it's supposed to be applause on
feels
the show.
Empty.
It's a strange feeling.
Yeah. Well,
but you guys are used to that stuff. See, empty studios and just
When we worked down in Dallas, you were there. We have an audience there.
I've never seen anything like that.
We have as many as 400 or 500 people that come by the ranch, actually, in Dallas, and are sort of on a tourist visit. They pay to enter while we're filming and so forth. They're all behind ropes. And you really are performing in front of about 500 people plus the crew. So it's large sequences with a couple hundred extras and things. So when you come back and you work on a set and you're in your own bedroom and there's nobody there,
you
go, I'm not working. Where's the audience? I can't work without an audience.
Now tell the truth. When we were down there, I've said this and people do not believe it. We checked the temperature. And we had one of these covers over where we were talking to people.
If you were smart, you did.
117 degrees, and we were shaded.
That's a cold snap. No, I know that. Because Barbara, I remember, gets the most. She really gets dingy with it. Because it does do something to you, that constant heat.
Oh.
I remember there was a motel scene when I was first down there doing the show that was with JR, and it was just by the airport, near the airport. So, of course, we had to always hold for airplanes going over. And this tiny room, and the whole crew, and everybody in there, Lenny was directing.
No air.
Larry dropped 10 pounds there.
Well, we all put up with it for fame and fortune. You know how it is.
tough.
But it's always a tough two months down there.
Your part has gotten more interesting, Steve.
Thank you.
Hasn't it?
Thank you. Well,
are
it's
you
just
pleased?
A, it's a situation of staying in there, doing your best work, hoping they pay attention sooner or later and come around your way. And last year was a much better year for my character, and I think this year it's sort of maintaining that level at this point.
Now, you said 85 countries. Do you visit these countries ever? And why don't you go over and film at the... You were in Israel, weren't you?
Yes, sir. I remember last time I told you I was going to go to Israel. Susan from the show and Lee McCloskey and Audrey Landers and various husbands and wives and relatives went along on this trip for 8 days to Israel. And, of course, they see Dallas there, and the Jordanians see it, the Syrians see it, they've seen it throughout Asia and Eastern Europe, Western Europe. They even get it in Russia, because in Denmark, the airwaves, by chance, are picked up by Russian signals.
That's exciting. Isn't that exciting?
Yeah.
How do they react to you in countries like that?
Well, of course...
Are they much different than here?
No. No, of course you don't understand them when they're talking to you.
If they loved you or hated you, you don't know.
After Israel, I took my wife was with me, Brett, and I went to Paris for and to London, and we were kind of vacationing.
Are you in Paris? Is Dallas in Paris?
Yes, yes. And I'm a great art lover, and we were in the Louvre and in the Tate in London, and everywhere we went, literally, we were sort of chased out, and it would be the Japanese tourists in one sense, or it would be a group of Italians or a bunch of Germans or something, and they'd just come and go, Ray, Yuling, sign this, take the pictures. I'm in front of a Gauguin, I'm enjoying it, and suddenly I'm being swarmed by a large group of Japanese there with cameras.
God, I love it. Click.
Anyway,
is it true what they say in England that when the show's on the air, everything literally stops?
The show has an incredible appeal. If producers could design a show that did this every time, every show would have these kind of numbers, I suppose. But it seems to be. I'm at Menachem Begin in Israel, and wherever I go, I find that there's heads of state that watch this show, and guys that work in a factory, and
wonderful.
The people who live out in the rural communities. There's a broad base of appeal for the program, and it's because everybody looks at it on a different level. To some people, it's very camp, and to others, it's reality. So
I know. Yeah.
And of course, he knew you. Mr. Begin.
Oh, Begin said, well, he had one great question, of course, and it was the one that's asked 1,000 times, who shot
J.R.?
they were watching programs from the second year.
I see.
And some of the countries are just receiving our first year's broadcast now.
Oh, wow.
And some are current.
That is incredible.
One of the big things they're trying to do is make a film of our show this season. And Laura Mars, very... serious about trying to produce a feature film of Dallas.
Why not?
Well, that's what they're saying. You might consider, not Star Wars, what's the other space show? Star Wars.
Star Trek.
Oh, yeah.
That did 67 million so far.
And after the show is off the air. So Laura Meyer's position is, well, the show is so hot in all these foreign countries and so big.
Wait.
Do it now. We're broadcasting. Why wait till the show is off the air?
Can you imagine, though?
And we're going to be syndicated in 1984. We'll be on daily.
Poor baby is going to just sit back and count the residuals.
Well,
It's funny when you talk about finance.
It's a roll of the dice. It was a few years ago. I was at the unemployment office.
Haven't forgotten either.
I haven't forgotten.
I must ask you, Steve, if I may, about the current TV Guide's cover story on Victoria, which doesn't paint a very good picture for Victoria Principal. So she's quite self-centered, an aggressive woman.
Have you ever met her?
I had her on the show for a week.
Sure. I think she's a fascinating woman. I've known Victoria since...
Sure what? Wait a minute. I said that she's self-centered and aggressive, and Steve says...
Have you met her?
No, I didn't. Sure, she's a great
Pass
woman. She's, come on, I've heard of being invasive, but that phrasing really got me.
What am I supposed to say? I had the article here in my pocket a minute ago. I did read
it. You were laughing when you were reading it.
Yeah, and I loved it. Victoria may be offended, but...
Do you think, really, that's what I'm wondering? Because I think she's so above, I don't know
what... I think she probably is, too. That's why I say she may be. The one thing I admire about Victoria, besides she's gorgeous and very professional,
she really is, and
she does a wonderful job at what she does, is that she's got this great attitude about life. She's kind of a loner, and she's very independent. She makes the choices. She has designed her life from the very beginning.
Oh, you bet your bananas she's happy.
This article said, and she's not very happy about the way things are. Well, I disagree. I think this woman is very much in control of her life, and she's very happy. And she's a fun gal, and keeps life exciting. You know,
she
I like that.
She is. I saw her do one thing that gave me a whole reading on Victoria Principle. Kathy Bach was on the show, who also is not a can of worms, folks.
No.
From TV. And we were playing baseball, mm-hmm. and they had this woman pitcher who could throw the ball like a bullet, and Kathy Bach hit it. Victoria hadn't hit it, and she insisted on trying again. Mm. I mean, I said, we're finished with the pitch. She says, I want to try that again. And she said, and I want you to film it. And I said, well, we may not film it, but you could try it. And she hit it. I got news for you.
Very determined.
She hung in there. She's a determined young lady, and I got real good reading. Will you stay?
Well,
because we're going to get an answer on this.
Yeah,
No.
I have to go.
Do you stay?
It's for my wife.
Well, there's one right
on.
Oh, no.
Wife.
Oh, your wife.
Yeah,
oh.
She's expecting me.
Oh, I thought she's expecting again.
Oh, no.
Wait.
No,
we have.
Really
had
I wish.
I'll let you go, Steve.
I'm sorry.
You got some wonderful people.
I know. I've had a great fun talking to him in the green room.
Stuart Granger and Melvin Bell.
I'm going to get him a cowboy hat from a friend of mine in Dallas.
Well, you know, you're welcome to come back anytime.
It's been my pleasure.
And maybe the next time I'll get an answer from you.
No. Steve, I got to work with a girl.
We'll be right back with attorney Melvin Bell right after this.